We're going to get started. We already have some people with us, and since we have three fantastic speakers today, I want to dive right in so you hear mostly from them and less from me, but wonderful to see who's on with us today, calling in already from three different countries. So please continue to, this is Marnie Summer, please continue to share with us in the chat box who you are, where you are. What we really hope is that the Period Posse webinar speaking series is not just to learn from those who join us and share their knowledge and insights, but also is a platform for you all to network and find each other and other people working on similar issues. So great to know who you are, where you are, and if you see somebody working on the issue located nearby, I hope you will connect offline. Feel free to share your email addresses in the chat box as well. We won't be making that public when we post the recording. So this is our final Period Posse Presents webinar for this season, Menstruation and Homelessness, the Double Taboo. We're sorry to have our season end, but we will look forward to getting started again in September, which I'll mention again at the end today. And we're really grateful to have three fantastic speakers to talk with us about all that they've learned and what their advice is and thoughts are moving ahead. Okay, so for those of you who maybe missed last month's webinar, as you can see at the bottom, all of the recordings for our prior webinars, and I think there's around 18 of them now, are posted on the Period Posse Presents website. You can just Google Period Posse Presents webinars and it will pop up, or use the link that Caitlin has kindly provided on the screen. And last month's is up there as well. There you go. It's also in the chat box. So as you can see, we've really had a wonderful lineup. We're super grateful for the people willing to put in the hard work to gather some great slides and talk to our audience. And we've covered what's been a really nice range of issues and locations around the world with speakers from all different places these past few months. We will be working on our lineup for the new series over this, what are the summer months here in the US, and we'll get that out to you probably in August so you can get all signed up and ready for the new season. So I want to just dive in. Again, if you're just joining us now, welcome. Please feel free to put your name, organization, location in the chat box so you all can find each other. But for those of you who are perhaps less familiar with the topic of homelessness, we just wanted to have a couple slides to talk about what we meant by homelessness. So for those experiencing it, they may be living on the street, moving between temporary locations, living in boarding houses. I think sometimes people make an assumption that it's only the people that you see on the street that are considered homeless, but actually that's not, it's a much more inclusive definition that gets at all the sort of unstable or inadequate housing conditions people live in. Some of the things to think about that may make it even harder for those experiencing homelessness, there may be physical or mental health challenges, there may be higher rates of substance use and more vulnerable, obviously, to weather conditions, whether that's extreme cold or extreme hot, really just depends where people are. And just also to flag, our speakers today are from the US and the UK, but obviously the issue of homelessness is global. It may not have the same terminology in every location. And so we just wanted to flag as well some of the different terms or concepts that people may use in different parts of the world so that we know what we're all talking about and recognize, depending on where you're dialing in from, how you may refer to this issue. Just sort of the box at the bottom, what we also wanted to just highlight. Some of these conditions may be sort of off and on, they may not be permanent, people may move in and out of situations of homelessness. Either way, it obviously poses many challenges to health and well-being, and particularly to the issue of menstruation, as we're going to hear about today. And again, very exciting to see all the people popping up in different time zones from different locations. So please do continue to share who you are and where you are so we can learn who's with us today. In terms of the numbers of people experiencing homelessness, one of the things that we thought was important to flag is that there were already an enormous number of people, 2% of the world's population, who are considered to be homeless. But then also we wanted to indicate sort of there's the 150 million, that the additional 1.6 billion who lacked adequate housing. But we wanted to sort of flag here as well, sort of the impact of COVID-19. I know as somebody living in New York City, it certainly seems like there's a rise in homelessness in the population in my city. I suspect, and I think we hear news that this is happening all over the world. We have there that it may be invisible only in that these people may not be being counted, or they may have sort of the inadequate housing conditions. So maybe they're living with different people. Maybe they're staying in temporary places. Just because you're not seeing them on the street does not mean that COVID-19 is not contributing to increased situations of inadequate housing conditions. So then just for those of you who may be new joining us today for the first time, so welcome if you are. What do we mean by menstruation? Just a brief history. Back in 2012, we came up with a definition. This was linked to some lobbying that was happening to develop the Sustainable Development Goals, and we needed to have a definition by which we could measure whether there was an impact and progress happening. Over the years, this terminology has, as it should, continue to evolve. There was a shift towards thinking about calling it the menstrual experience, one that would encompass both what people were calling menstrual health and menstrual hygiene. And then literally, maybe just in the last week and a half, a new definition came out in a paper, and the link is at the bottom. I believe this is an open access journal. So you can go and read through this at your leisure. It's a much more comprehensive way of thinking about what menstrual health is. I won't have you read through it now, but I would encourage you to go look for it. So just to sort of wrap up sort of these framing slides so we can get to the speakers, there's really been growing attention to the issue of menstruation and homelessness. These are just some headline articles from across the pond in Ireland. There's news articles have popped up in India, in Asia, in Kenya. So just to say that this really is a global issue. And so again, although our speakers today are coming from two countries, we certainly could one day have a webinar that encompasses the more global nature of this issue. So lastly, we always like to conclude our framing slides with a quote. And this is just a reminder, I was going to edit it because everyone has the right to a standard of living adequate for the health and well-being of himself. I wanted to edit this to say herself or oneself. So just use that whatever gendered terminology you want to use, but including food, clothing, housing, medical, and necessary social services. So I think this is a really appropriate quote for all that we're going to cover today. Okay, so just some reminders, again, for those of you who may be new to joining us today, please, as you are already doing, engage with the chat box. Let us know who you are, where you are. Feel free to share, as we've already got two film screenings about periods that have been put in the chat box. We really encourage the sharing of resources. We will provide speaker contact at the end in case you want to follow up and connect with any of them. We will also have a Q&A session at the end, but if you just scroll up in Zoom, you will see that along with the chat box, you can click and open a Q&A box. We would encourage you to open the Q&A box. So if you have questions that come up during the speakers, feel free to enter them in the Q&A box. And when the speakers are done, they will go in there and try to answer them in advance of the Q&A session. It's always good to have your chat box and your Q&A box open. If you will be tweeting, and we certainly encourage tweeting just so we can have more people out there think about the issues of menstruation and homelessness, and you will see the hashtags down there in the corner. So our speakers today, Shailini Vora, who will speak about work from the UK, Caitlin Grewer, who's on our team here at Columbia, will talk about some research that we did in New York City in 2019, and then Genevieve Schutzis, we are very grateful, is joining us from the other side of America, and it's extremely early in the morning, so we're really grateful that she is up and with us today. So Shailini, I'm just going to hand the slides over to you. And if you want to unmute yourself, you should have access.
Hi, Hello, can you hear me?
Yes, we can hear you. All
Great.
good.
Amazing. So thank you so much, Marnie, for the great introduction. And hi, everyone. I've been reading all of your bios and you all sound so amazing. So I'm really, really grateful to be here today to speak to you all about this. Right, let's see if I can control these slides. There we go. So today I'm just going to talk to you a little bit about the research that I've done, talk about the specific needs and experiences of menstruators experiencing homelessness, and what else needs to be done to support this group. So my research took place in Bristol, in the UK, which is a city in southwest England, and it has the fifth highest number of rough sleepers in the UK. And a quarter of these are estimated to be single women. Although, as Marnie mentioned, this number may be a gross underestimate because homelessness isn't just about rough sleeping. It's about also people staying in hostels, staying with family and friends, staying in shelters as well. I conducted my research with 40 people who identify as cis women, and all of them were experiencing varying form of homelessness. So some of them were rough sleeping. Others were staying in the homes of friends and family. Some stayed in emergency night shelters. And I also spoke to people accessing day centres and drug support centres. So the kind of aim of my research was I wanted to understand their daily realities as marginalised menstruators, and how they navigated their homelessness while they were menstruating, specifically in that context of social exclusion and limited financial resources. I also analysed the effectiveness of charitable initiatives that support menstruators who are homeless. Kind of looking at the needs that came up within my research and connecting them to things that were going on in the community and seeing whether they matched up. So I'm just going to touch on a little bit about the complex needs of people experiencing homelessness. So people experiencing homelessness disproportionately suffer from mental health issues, and this is particularly important when we're looking at menstruation because of pre and post-menstrual disorders and how that these can be exacerbated if you are struggling with your mental health. Women are much more likely to have become homeless due to domestic violence. They engage in survival sex and are more likely to be a victim to gender-based violence on the streets. And again, really, really important when looking at menstruation because histories of trauma around sexual abuse can really change the way that you see your body, the way that you connect to your body, which can affect the way that you manage your menstruation. And actually one of the women that I was working with, she had a very, very similar story. She'd struggled with a lot of sexual abuse in her childhood and couldn't physically talk about her periods with us. And that was a lot of kind of slow and supported work with her so we could support her. I used to work for a charity called St. Mungo's who work with people experiencing homelessness in the UK. And over half of all the people that we work with struggle with substance use and addiction. This could be, it was mostly, heroin, crack, and alcohol. And obviously this addictions affect your physical health, which in turn affects your menstrual cycle. A lot of the women that I spoke to sometimes skipped meals, that had their appetite suppressed by the substances that they were taking, and therefore were skipping periods as well. Another really important thing to highlight is the disproportionate experience of care and the criminal justice system amongst people experiencing homelessness. And this really disrupts your education. It disrupts your family ties. And where do we learn about our periods? We learn about it through our family members, through our biology lessons. And when this education is disruptive, albeit it's not always a complete education, it can really affect the way that people view themselves and view their periods. So I'm going to just share a couple of quotes with you that came up within my research and highlight key themes. So most of the women I spoke to framed their period as negative, as painful, and that it exacerbated mental health conditions. Issues of menstruation are compounded by homelessness. So people experiencing homelessness have the added pressures of their constant mobility, their insecurity, they're looking for the next place of shelter, the next toilet, when they'll next be able to buy some tampons. Many of the women I spoke to just yearned for a space to be still, to rest. Their continuous movement through the streets of the city to different houses of friends, different hostels, really undermines your ability to self-care and rest. And in this particular example, this person had very severe and heavy periods, and her physical vulnerabilities were really intensified due to her situation. Something that's come up a lot in my research, and it's the name of this webinar as well, the double taboo, the double stigma of experiencing homelessness and also menstruating. So this interview participant that you see on the left was re-articulating common notions of people experiencing homelessness and menstruators as kind of messy and dirty. And her embodiment of both really places her in a doubly stigmatized and marginalized position. On the right, someone said, "I really just don't want to feel like an intruder anymore." And her embarrassment of this also really highlights these stark contrasts between the need for privacy when you are menstruating. You want to go to the toilet, you just want to shower, you want to rest, but also that kind of your body being starkly public, especially as a rough sleeper. As many of you may have imagined, finance was really, really difficult for most of the women that I spoke to. Most of them didn't have money to buy pads and tampons, and many of them used toilet paper, others used nappies, t-shirts. One of the women that I spoke to shoplifted her products because what else can you do when you don't have the money to buy? We did speak about alternative products such as menstrual cups. I did ask the participants whether they would be interested in using a menstrual cup, something that's a bit more sustainable, you can carry around with you. But many of them highlighted the difficulty of this. They don't have access to places to wash their menstrual cup. And one of the women I spoke to was like, "Shay, come on. I am trashed most days. I don't know where any of my stuff is. I always lose everything. So no, I cannot be tasked with the responsibility of carrying around a menstrual cup." And it just also highlights the kind of chaotic lives that people who are experiencing homelessness experience. There was also an issue of power and control and communication. Some women found asking for products and homelessness services really, really embarrassing. And some didn't actually even know that you could access them from certain services. However, it just wasn't the taboo and the embarrassment that were putting people off, but the institutional power relations that existed between service users and staff in certain homeless shelters. So in all of the services that I visited, apart from one, staff had control over the supply of menstrual products, which in a way is a form of exerting power. They have control as to whether people could access menstrual products. And this is a barrier, especially if you're shy about it, you're worried, you don't want to talk about it, you don't want to disclose your menstrual status. And it can be particularly hard for trans and non-binary people who may not present as femme, but also menstruate, to disclose that information, to ask that for that information. So looking forward now, what can we take away from my research? So firstly, for practitioners, improved access and services is really, really important. Providing a range of products, people manage their menstruation differently. In gender-neutral toilets, ensuring that toilets are clean, safe, and secure. Definitely providing laundry, showers, and lockers, safe places where people can keep their stuff, really, really help. And definitely improving education, which in turn improves communication. Training staff to speak more freely about menstruation and being more knowledgeable about different products that exist, different experiences of menstruation, whether that be the trans and non-binary experience of menstruation or even different cultures. And this would help to support people who access services to feel more comfortable about expressing their needs. What else? More research. So my research was only 40 cis women who are mostly white. So we definitely need more experiences. I know that lots of great work is going on already. Just to document different experiences of homelessness in different countries, different spectrums of homelessness, of refugees, of trans and non-binary people who experience homelessness, of parents and carers. And further understanding how these complex needs that are so specific to homelessness can compound that experience of menstruation, such as substance use and trauma. I really, really recommend the Palgrave Handbook of Critical Menstruation Studies. I'm sure it's been talked about before on this webinar, but it is open access. You can find it online, and you can also read my research in there too. Big things for policymakers and donors. I mean, yeah, we really, really need to work to end poverty and homelessness, because these issues wouldn't occur if poverty and destitution didn't exist. So we must continue to challenge the structural inequalities that allow homelessness to occur. And I really think that we need to campaign for different ways of teaching menstruation. I mean, I'm sure all of you can agree that, I mean, my first experience of learning about menstruation was looking at two ovaries and a uterus in a biology book. It wasn't culturally relevant. It didn't include different genders. I didn't know how to relate to these images I was seeing in a book as a 9-year-old. So having more inclusive and comprehensive menstrual education is really, really important. And that is it from me. Thank you so much. I'm looking forward to answering your questions in the Q&A later. Thank you all.
Wonderful. Thank you, Shailini. That was a fantastic presentation and really set the stage, I think, for all that we're hearing today. Welcome to those of you who are new and who've come online in the last sort of 10 minutes. This is Marnie Somer. Please open up your chat box. It's already great. We can see where people are located, what organizations. Please continue to add your location and your name so we can get to know who's with us today. And also please open up the Q&A box. We already have one question in there, and we will continue to gather questions and we will take them at the end. And the speakers can also dive in there as Shailini is currently doing and respond. So we're now going to move from Bristol, England, where we heard some really powerful and important insights around the experiences of those who are homeless and menstruation, over to New York City, and have Caitlin Grewer talk about a study that we did this summer of 2019. Hold on, I'm just having some mouse issues. Okay, Caitlin, you should have access now.
Excellent. Good morning, good evening, and good afternoon, everyone, depending on where you are in the world. As Marnie mentioned, I will be talking about a study that we did in New York City in 2019, looking at the menstrual management experiences of people living on the street and in shelters of New York City. In terms of our background and rationale, as we started to look at these experiences, there was quite minimal evidence on the menstrual experiences of those experiencing homelessness, particularly in the US. And what we did find is within the evidence that did exist, much of it really focused on menstrual products instead of looking at the full range of challenges related to menstruation that these populations were experiencing. And then also in New York, there was this interesting aspect in that in 2016, the city had passed a policy mandating that all homeless shelters provide free access to menstrual products within the shelters to their clients, but there was quite limited information on what the rollout of that looked like. So our study aim was to understand the menstrual experiences of people living both on the street and in shelters in New York City. You can see here, as I'm sure many of you are aware, New York City in the northern east coast of the United States. The homeless situation in New York is quite interesting. New York City has the largest homeless population in the US, but the homeless population looks quite different than in many other cities because New York City has a court mandated right to shelter. And so because of that, as you can see here, about 95% of the homeless population actually lives in shelters, although there are about between 3,500 and 4,000 people living on the street. It is likely that both of these numbers here are underestimates. And then we also expect that this number has increased during the COVID pandemic and will continue to increase as we continue to see the economic impact of the pandemic. So this was just a very small study conducted between June and August of 2019. We conducted key informant interviews with staff of homeless service organizations and government agencies. We conducted in-depth interviews with people living on the street and in shelters. While our study was open to all people who had experiences of menstruation and homelessness, only cisgendered women self-selected into our study. So throughout this, you will hear me referring pretty much exclusively to women. And then we also worked with a GIS expert at the CUNY School of Public Health to conduct audits of public toilets around areas that had high concentrations of people experiencing homelessness. So in terms of our major findings, you will hear me echoing many of the things that Shailini presented as well. So the first was uncertain access to safe, clean, private spaces for changing menstrual products, both for those living in shelters, especially single adult shelters. There was a lack of clean, functioning, private toilets, and then particularly for those living on the street. The number of public toilets that were clean and functioning was much lower than was necessary. And also many public toilets aren't available 24 hours a day, leaving the population living on the street without many options. In addition, across both shelter bathrooms and public bathrooms, they often didn't have an adequate stock of bathroom necessities, which become much more necessary when you have your period. So for example, toilet paper for wrapping up a used pad or even just for cleaning yourself when you have your period. And then at many of the shelters, they had policies during the day limiting access to many of the shelter facilities. So women weren't able to go up to the dorm floors where most of the bathrooms were. So because of all of these things, both those living on the street and living in shelters tended to depend on commercial establishments, particularly fast food restaurants, to go to the bathroom. But these had barriers to use. Often you had to have a code or you had to buy something, and they weren't always friendly to people who looked homeless. So we have this quote here, using the bathrooms while living on the subway was just terrible. Like the bathrooms in the city are like disgusting. And this is a theme we heard over and over again about the lack of cleanliness. We also heard difficulties around bathing and laundering. Within the shelters, there were issues related to the privacy, safety, and cleanliness of the bathing facilities. And for those living on the street, there was a massive shortage of showering options and locations. And then for both those living on the street and in shelters, there was limited laundry access. So there were very few options for free laundry, which meant that many people ended up washing things in sinks or even throwing out bloodstained items because they found there were more service providers where they could get new clothes than where they could do their laundry. So all of this interacts with menstrual stigma. So many of the people we talked to experienced quite strong shame and embarrassment around both being homeless and their menstruation, which particularly during their menstruation affected their confidence and their engagement in daily activities. There was this strong association and fear of menstrual leaks and odors, and particularly the idea that someone else might be able to tell that they were menstruating which if you don't have access to bathing or laundry facilities, you can understand it would be quite difficult to prevent menstrual leaks. And this also intersected with this notion of passing or the ability to not look homeless, which was really important for people to be able to go to work or to move about the city to access other services without harassment or to gain access to those commercial toilets we were mentioning earlier. So I think this is a really good quote to encapsulate this. I feel like the most annoying thing when being like living outside and getting your periods is leaking through your clothes. It's embarrassing, and it shouldn't have to necessarily be embarrassing, but it is. And then finally, there is insufficient and inconsistent access to menstrual products. So while many of the shelters did provide access to these products and the people experiencing homelessness that we talked to were very grateful for that, many of the distribution systems, either at the shelters or at other service providers, they only handed out a small number of pads or tampons at one time. In some cases, they were quite low quality products. They were too thin, so women had to change them very frequently. Or the provider only had pads or only had tampons, so women couldn't get their preference. The distribution systems, as Shailini mentioned in her work, we also found that they tended to require asking someone for the products. And this person was very often male. It could be someone that the women had a difficult relationship with, and they were often located in a very public space. So there's a lot of embarrassment associated with this, and some women simply didn't feel comfortable asking those people. And so as a result, women reported many different coping strategies. So many of them reported using t-shirts or socks or wads of toilet paper in place of menstrual products, while others resorted to panhandling or begging, or in a few cases, stealing, as that was the only way they could get these products. So this top quote relates to the gatekeeper issue. The humiliation is that you have to keep going back to them and asking them. And when you're asking for, because they have police and security, so it's not private. So you're asking for it in front of the New York Police Department and the Department of Homeless Services Security. And most of those are male staff. And then someone else explaining that she could get more cigarettes than tampons when she was begging. So in terms of key takeaways for practitioners, one is that we think it's very important to train the staff, both male and female staff, because if they're trained on menstruation, it could help to break down some of this stigma and to improve their comfort in providing these services and thus the experience of the women. And then also rethinking the distribution strategies to reduce the barriers to access. So if possible, freely available products would be the best case scenario. And we do know it's happening at some places around the city, so it is viable. Also increasing the quantity and quality of the materials provided. And then to ensure that all populations have access to these products, expanding the locations either to more service providers around the city or potentially to public toilets across the city. For policymakers, we need to improve access to safe, clean, private toilets, both in public spaces and within the shelters. Increase the availability of showers and laundry options for all populations. And then also provide access to menstrual products for all vulnerable populations. So in New York, expanding that access to those living on the streets, but also, as I mentioned, those in New York City probably have, because of this policy, have better access to menstrual products than people experiencing homelessness almost anywhere else in the country. So making sure that other cities have things like this. I think this quote just really encapsulates what we're looking at. So what we need is just more access in more spaces with less stigma. And then we just want to say that we did have a number of collaborators, the two service providers, the Coalition for the Homeless and the Door, who helped us access women experiencing homelessness, and also a wonderful team of both students and co-investigators from Columbia and CUNY Schools of Public Health. Thank you so much.
Wonderful. Thank you so much, Caitlin. That was, and it's really just so striking to me, the similarities that we're seeing. Sorry, I need to take back access. The similarities we're seeing in both countries, and even though these are small studies, which, you know, I hopefully there will be more attention to this issue, which Genevieve is going to help us get with her advocacy background and talk. But clearly there are obvious themes that are coming up in both locations. So again, it's, I think we have more new people. Please just let us know where you are, where you're dialing in from in the chat box. And please also open up the Q&A box if you have any questions. Shailini's already answered two, I think, but if you have questions for Caitlin and if you have questions for Genevieve or just overall, we should have a little bit of time at the end of today to move to Q&A session. So let me just give Genevieve access. Okay, over to Genevieve, who got up super, super early, 4:30 in the morning, to join us today. So thank you so much, Genevieve.
Hi, thank you for the introduction. It was really great to see the work that Caitlin and Shailini have been doing. And I am here to present a little bit of a different perspective from the advocacy side. So my name is Genevieve or Genevieve Schutzius, depending if you're who you're talking to. I am dialing in from Portland, Oregon, located on the ancestral lands of the Multnomah, Clackamas, and Cowlitz tribes, among many others in this area. And as Marnie mentioned, the local time is not quite 6 a.m., so I apologize in advance for any blunders that may occur during the presentation. So by day, I work as an environmental engineer, but I am wearing my sanitation and hygiene hat today, representing Public Hygiene Lets Us Stay Human, or FLUSH for short, where I serve as the board president currently. Let's see if I...
There you go.
There we go. So FLUSH is an all-volunteer registered nonprofit born in 2005 out of the realization that there is a serious lack of public restrooms in the United States. We formed in the Pacific Northwest, but we've expanded into other regions. In particular, we're just about to unveil a new chapter in Cincinnati. And we also partner with organizations around the country and the world to promote advocacy for public restrooms. In the last 10 years, we've broadened our advocacy to include emergency sanitation preparedness, as well as all user restroom access. And this includes advocating for safe hygienic facilities for people experiencing homelessness and menstruation. So I just want to give a little snapshot of our advocacy journey and how this ties into the menstruation issue and the homelessness issue. We began in 2005. Our co-founders recognized the need for public restrooms in the downtown Portland area. One of our founding members lived close to several people living on the street who constantly struggled to find a place to go. And on the other end, another founder was a restaurant owner who disliked seeing no public restroom signs, but realized there were few other options for other business owners. So in 2006 and 2007, we partnered with the city and the Portland State University to create a task force designing and implementing the placement of new public restrooms. The Portland Loo was the toilet born of this teamwork. It's designed and fabricated by Madden Fabrication in Portland. And the first one was placed in 2008, and there are now many loos in over 20 locations across the continent, North America. And this toilet is unique in that it is designed to be easily cleaned and conducive. Oh, sorry, having a tech issue with my screen. 1 minute. Okay, there we go. easily cleaned and not conducive to folks being able to stay for long periods of time, making it available for everyone. We've also created a public toilet advocacy toolkit, which provides guidance for advocates working in their own cities. And in 2012, we adopted, You can still see everything. Okay.
Yeah, we can see everything. And I can hit next if that's easier for you.
Nope, I'm good. I just have a screen that doesn't work very well. So.
Okay.
Yeah, so following the Christchurch, New Zealand damaging earthquake, we adopted their twin bucket emergency toilet. And we now use that to promote preparation for what to do in the aftermath of a seismic event or any other emergency that could make it more difficult to use the restroom. So here's where the issue becomes more relevant to menstruation and homelessness. In 2015, we worked with the city commissioner to draft and pass the all user restroom guidance. This was unanimously passed by city council. Now we are beginning to support and engage in local initiatives that will support sanitation access to the homeless, and are just getting started in the important intersection of menstrual hygiene and restrooms. So the all-user restroom guidance challenged the business community to convert over 1,000 single-stall restrooms into all-user restrooms by 2017. And it states, quote, "This simple act will benefit everyone, including parents with young children, older adults, people with a disability or who require an attendant, in the transgender community," which is really, really great. And it's a really awesome start, but who is being left out of the conversation? Homeless, people experiencing homeless and people experiencing menstruation are not mentioned in the all user restroom guidance. So the work that remains, although we have come a long way in our advocacy, is very clear. We must include people experiencing homelessness and those who are menstruating in the conversation, period. So some challenges that remain include the fact that, as I said, populations of concern are not included in this conversation. And as well, homelessness and menstruation are highly politicized taboo topics, which does make it difficult to, but not impossible, to instigate change for these populations. Also, measures that have proposed thus far typically only address one issue or one population. For example, bills that provide menstrual products but don't include the homeless in the conversation. So I want to give some examples of real world applications that can be helpful in this issue. So one practice that is in effect is sanitation or hygiene centers or pubs. This is really important. As Shailini highlighted, while being helpful for some shelters can be less desirable for people experiencing homelessness. And for that reason, we need to be providing sanitation and hygiene services in other ways. Female and menstruator-friendly toilets, which include sinks, such as those that are paired in typical porta potties. Those are just one really easy way to solve part of the sanitation and hygiene puzzle. An example shown here is called the Hygiene for All Hub, and it was recently opened in Portland, Oregon. And it includes much more than just toilets. As Caitlin was mentioning, there are many other facets that are part of that puzzle, and making it much more comfortable and conducive to a comfortable menstruation experience for those living on the street or those who might just be passing through and in need of these services. This hub in Portland includes a laundry exchange, a clothing and bedding exchange, and also a mobile shower unit, which those are gaining a lot of traction, we have noticed. There's also storage areas, which can be really helpful for managing material possessions, and a health pod. So I want to highlight this especially because folks can receive medical treatment, but also products such as menstrual products. So this could be an easy and safe space to access these important products. This grouping of services is really helpful for reducing the shame and stigma that we've talked about that is associated with resorting to undesirable methods of obtaining menstrual supplies. And it also just provides a safe space to keep clean, to rest, and to maintain dignity. So another consideration in practice is how can we make menstrual products more easy to access within public restrooms? One idea that is in use at the hygiene hub that I mentioned is hiring homeless persons as restroom attendants such that they would be able to provide products in a safe space. So this would provide the benefit of giving a work opportunity and would also allow for a more pleasant restroom and menstruation experience. Another great idea is advances in menstrual product dispensers. I think those relic dispensers we see around, like the one pictured here, are probably from the Middle Ages. Hoo-ha is an app that can be linked with some of these dispensers so that folks can obtain products using their phone. And these could be paired with programs providing discounted or no-cost supplies to persons experiencing homelessness. So on the policy side, I just wanted to highlight a couple bills that have been introduced in state legislatures, mostly regarding menstrual product access and taxes. One example here is currently being considered in Oregon, House Bill 3294. It is still in committee, but its goal is to provide free menstrual products in schools. Some others that are being considered in this state include reducing taxes for distributors, such that it would be a lower cost for distributors to sell products, and then also adding SNAP or WIC benefits to include funds for menstrual products to those of lower income. And these are just a snapshot of many bills being considered all across the country. There are many, many that I can't even keep track of. There's a lot of this conversation going on right now. And the ways to move this policy forward is to contact your legislatures, reach out to your representatives in support of this legislation. And what's more, we do need to involve the other side of the coin here. We need to encourage our policymakers to be including those people experiencing homelessness in this conversation and promoting more bills that would include everyone that we are considering. So if you are able also to offer assistance promoting or implementing these legislative goals, that is another way to move them forward. And as well, Shalini and Caitlin highlighted this in a really great way, but continuing the research, continuing to gather qualitative and quantitative data to monitor our progress on this issue. Who can we be talking to really understand the full picture of the situation that folks are experiencing? What questions really get to the root of this issue and to represent all populations of concern? So who is missing in the conversation that needs to be talked to so that we can bridge that gap between policymakers and practitioners to better serve the needs of the menstruators and the people experiencing homelessness in our communities. So in summary, just three takeaways. I've been driving this point home, but who else should be included in the conversation? That is what we always need to be asking in our advocacy. Ask what they need and get creative in offering these sanitation services that can benefit everyone. We've seen awesome new exciting ways to provide sanitation and hygiene services, but there are constantly new, really great ideas being thrown out on the table, and it's a constantly morphing field of advocacy. So finally, get analytical and remain empathetic to understand the true efficacy of programs, because we all deserve restrooms, including those experiencing homelessness and menstruation. Thank you very much.
Wonderful. What a fantastic, I mean, I'm so grateful. This is our final season, our final webinar of the season, but to have three such interesting pieces that all really just support each other and speak to both the important learning that has begun and all of the ways in which we can try to engage on this issue and affect change, which clearly we still have a lot to do. There has been an active Q&A activity going on in the Q&A box. I'm just going to scroll through and read some of them so that if you want to open the Q&A box, you can just see where we've been going in terms of questions. And then I am going to pose some questions just for a few minutes because I want to make sure we wrap up on time. There was a question around, did menopausal, premenopausal menstruation issues come up, and Shailini responded to that. There was questions around if those experiencing homelessness wanted to use contraceptives to suppress menstruation, and if that was an issue. There was a question around menstrual pain and how they were managing, if that came up and if they had access. If the issue of underwear came up, which I know it did in New York, and Caitlin has responded to that. The way menstruation may or may not be coming up in encampment areas and informal shelter settings, which Caitlin has responded to. That was also something we've been thinking a lot about because our team does research in emergency or humanitarian contexts. And certainly some of the learning from that is applicable. I think it goes both ways. So it was great to hear Genevieve comment on sort of what the response is in terms of flush that you recommend. I think it was the buckets, you know, when there is some kind of natural disaster in the area. Just the other thing I would say, which we haven't put in the chat box, but actually I think one of them was. So Shailini has a chapter more about her learning in the Rutledge Handbook of Critical Menstruation Studies. We have on our team published two papers so far, one about the toilet bathing laundering issues, one about the menstrual product access issues. We have another paper that will come out hopefully about the toilet audit findings, which hopefully we hope people will then replicate and do in other parts of the country and the world. And I really was thinking about, we have a fourth paper, which Flush is way ahead of us, but we were asked to submit something to a gender and law journal. So we got into a little bit the policy issues, and we actually talk a fair amount about the Portland Loo. So I'm so glad that came up today because it really is a model in terms of these standalone toilets and or single use toilets and what people have tried to do and which ones have worked better, with the Portland Loo being ahead of others. We have some unanswered questions. One, my research from Rebecca, my research is about menstrual experience in slums in Manila, and one site is in a cemetery. There's no water. So not totally a question, actually, Rebecca. But I think what it does do is it sort of brings to the forefront of our conversation that these are issues in all different parts of the world, and that we need to figure out what are some of the solutions. And then a question that's being coming up right now is how COVID has impacted the pressure to provide more public toilets and hand washing. I see that Genevieve is responding to that. I know in New York City, the Coalition for the Homeless put a lot of pressure on the government to provide porta potties and additional showers, which didn't work that well. I think it worked for a little time, but they're continuing to advocate for that in what they're advocating with the city right now. And I see Genevieve and Shailene, you're busy responding to that question. We have a question if public libraries ever came up, either as possible distribution locations. I don't know, Shailene, if you public libraries came up in Bristol, if that's something you want to speak to at all.
Hi. It came up as a space for rest. Okay. And it's a space frequented by a lot of the participants that I spoke to. I didn't speak to them about possible distribution locations for products or education, but that is a brilliant idea. And I definitely think it would work because libraries are definitely a space where people who are experiencing homelessness go.
Great.
To shelter during the day.
Great. And Genevieve, is, I don't know, I'm not sure if Flush intersects with this, but is there anything you would say? I know I'm going to leave Caitlin for last because I know what she's going to say, I think, and it's important. But was that something that you thought about over on the other coast of the country?
Sorry, I was typing a question, an answer.
No worries.
Can you repeat the question?
Yeah, no problem. Are public libraries as sites of sanitation or product distribution, or is that something that's come up over on the other side of the country?
You know, that is a really good one that I haven't heard mentioned very much.
Totally okay.
I think that's going with a previous question, we have also seen some resurgence in kind of temporary toilets and that kind of thing in high population, high traffic areas, but not specifically around public libraries, although those would be a good high traffic spot.
Great. And then Caitlin, I think it's important if you talk a little bit about what we learned about public libraries in New York City around this issue.
Sure. Yeah, so while we did not hear about them as possible distribution locations, we did during the public toilet audits that I mentioned, where we had a number of students who kind of went around certain areas of the city and tried to visit every public toilet within a quarter mile radius. They came across many public libraries, but many of them had either signs on the door saying that the bathrooms there were only available for library guests, or had signs more frequently saying that the bathrooms were broken or the bathrooms were closed. So there seemed to be, because similarly in New York City, I think there's quite a strong association between homeless populations and the libraries. If you go into many of the libraries, I think as Shailene was mentioning, you will see homeless people who are using it as a place to cool down or get warm and to use facilities. And so while we weren't able to talk to any of the people in the library, this seemed like potentially quite a pointed initiative around having so many of these public bathrooms closed, and or just something that it's a bathroom that you would expect these populations to be able to access. And so for whatever the reason, quite unfortunate that so many of them seem to be closed.
Yeah, no, it's, I think we have just this sort of one question really highlights the challenges. I think as the population of those experiencing homelessness swells, we do need to figure out ways to make all available public toilets accessible, respecting the needs of those organizations and institutions as well. And one of the things that our toilet policy paper, in talking to someone from the some of the folks in city government here in New York, is that just, and I don't know what other cities would find, but that the provision of public toilets is a key piece of the solution, but for a city the size of New York, and this may be different in different locations, that will not be sufficient in terms of a solution. But that's the toilet issue, unless the distribution. And it looks like we have a great response that in the California Bay Area, before COVID, that public libraries were definitely a preferred site for menstrual product access. So that's great to hear. I'm just realizing what time it is and that we're almost at the hour. So even though I wrote down a list of questions, I'm going to ignore my own list, but please do peruse the Q&A box to see the questions other people posed and that were answered. Just a reminder that we will be back in September. And we will be, you can sign up to be on our mailing list at any point, and the link is there where you can see at the bottom of the screen. And we will be posting a new schedule probably late summer. So that would be probably around August. You will get an updated schedule of our plan for the fall. future webinars. We want your ideas. And great, Caitlin just posted the mailing list in the chat box. We're always looking for sort of new thoughts, new speakers, issues people want to see covered that we haven't covered from all parts of the globe. So please do both send us ideas, sign up for the mailing list, and if you know budding period folks out there or people you think would benefit from joining this community and or seeing any of our past recordings, please just feel free to share our invites with them. For those of you who want to get in touch with our terrific speakers or us here at Columbia, that is their emails. I'm sure they would be happy to respond to any questions that you had. Maybe don't expect a response immediately, but they are out there and obviously have a wealth of learning amongst them. So maybe take a screenshot so that you have their emails if you want to follow up with them. Oh, and great to see the comments around trying to improve restroom access at bus stops. Yes, we can send the information if the Case for Her could repost the information about the Pandora's box screening. It looks like there's some interest just in seeing that as well. Oops, that was the last one. So thank you immensely to our fantastic speakers. It was, again, really a wonderful final webinar to have of the season. There's much work to be done, but I am personally feeling excited that we have such great people working in the space and that many people joined us today and there's a robust discussion. So I hope everybody has a wonderful rest of your day or a good sleep if you're in another time zone. And we look forward to seeing you and others online when we come back together in September. And Caitlin will be sending out in the next week the recording. So when that comes up, please feel free to share with your networks. Okay, I hope everybody has a wonderful rest of their day.